Before I begin, let me first tell you a little bit about myself. I grew up in a Christian home, went to church twice a week, went to a Christian summer camp, and I even went to a Christian school. So, as you can imagine, I grew up completely immersed in everything Christian. I recently saw this documentary, Jesus Camp, and I was surprised to see that it wasn't that far off from my own experiences at summer camp, and my church was anything but extreme. It was a part of the Christian and Missionary Alliance, and was mostly old people. So, I guess what I'm trying to say is that these camps are in operation all over America. It's not just one or two crazy factions out in the middle of nowhere. They're everywhere. Anyways, the film got me thinking about the kinds of things I was taught when I was little. So I went to a Christian bookstore, and I found my 7th grade science book. I'm going to read from this book and try to show the lies in the Christian textbooks. Unlike Kent Hovind, I'm not going to cherry-pick or quote out of context. Because, quite frankly, I don't need to. There's creationist propaganda littered throughout every page of this thing. I'll be reading from an Beka book called Science, Order, and Reality, Chapter 10, under a section which they really called Wild Imaginations. As the years went by, man's concept of nature became more and more distorted. Although the ancients had believed that the world was dominated by evil spirits and controlled by unpredictable gods, some of the Greek philosophers eliminated gods and spirits altogether in their ideas about the universe. They said that nature started by itself and kept itself going. The Greeks believed that everything is material, meaning that nothing is spiritual. This kind of erroneous thinking is known as materialism. The Greeks' explanation for the origin of life is known as spontaneous generation. The belief that living things can arise from non-living things. One Greek philosopher taught that living creatures were produced by mud. This idea made sense to the Greeks, because they believed that living creatures, including man, were nothing more than compositions of earthy materials. Let me pause here for a moment and try to explain where the writers of this book got the idea that men just came from mud. What they're referring to is pre-Socratic philosophy. It's around 500 BC. Where the philosophers stopped explaining things using gods, and instead began using logic and reason to explain the world around them. Notice how they don't portray this as a good thing, a shift toward real science. They portray it as a bad thing, a turning away from God. They then summarize the work of a man named Anaxagoras into one sentence: living creatures were produced by mud. What Anaxagoras really believed was that everything we see here today was originally a mixture of chaos, and through a process of like attracts like, that chaos slowly ordered, and eventually water, earth, and stone were formed. As this process continued, the seeds of life were formed, and were carried down to the earth with the rain. Vegetation, animals, and man then emerged from the warm, moist clay. Although it's still an odd theory, it is far more coherent than man simply came from mud. This is really just the authors trying to spin non-Christians as dumb and stupid, bumbling around in the dark, while portraying Christians as smart and intelligent, with God lighting their path. A common theme that you'll notice throughout this book is that they try to attribute most scientific progress to Bible-believing Christians, and attribute to non-Christians the crazy and disproven scientific theories that have come up over the years. A prime example of this is the idea that man came from mud, thought up by the materialist Greeks. And I'm not just making this up. This is what they say on page 362. They even bolded it so that it would stand out. The advancements of modern science became possible once man saw the truth about God, himself, and nature. I'll continue. The Greek ideas of creation without a creator were perhaps man's first attempt at developing a pattern of origin called evolution. Many scientists today still hold to the dated beliefs of materialism and evolutionism, refusing to allow any room in their ideas for the reality of an eternal God and the supernatural origin of life by divine creation. Okay, thought I'd get a bit farther than that, but this is actually a very common throughout this textbook and almost the entire Beka curriculum. Notice how they said that materialism and evolutionism are dated, and that the scientists refused to allow room for the reality of an eternal God. They're constantly reinforcing the idea that evolution is some crazy, harebrained belief that has been beaten and dismissed many years ago, when in fact it's not. It's the other way around. other reinforcement says that man dreams up this idea of evolution because it eliminates God, that anyone who believes in evolution thinks himself better than God. So, of course, any Christian would shudder at the thought of being so prideful. A conclusion is then drawn from this. Believing in evolution means that you don't believe in God. And that's not something many Christians are willing to accept. Keep in mind that this book is for 7th graders, 12 to 13 years old. And this is being taught in science class, and every other class for that matter. This kind of indoctrination is hard to get past. I was 20 by the time I finally realized that this was all a load of crap. This is why I think that so many Christians today are unwilling to accept evolution. Continuing on. Science could have exploded with advances during the age of the Greeks and Romans, were it not for their corrupted view of man and nature. Alright, just think for a moment about how ignorant that statement is while you watch this clip from The Life of Brian.
They bled us white at last. They take everything we had. And not just from us, from our fathers, and from our fathers' fathers.
And from our fathers' fathers' fathers.
Yeah.
And from our fathers' 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 fathers.
You're right, Stan, don't labor the point. And what have they ever given us in return?
The aqueduct?
What?
The aqueduct.
Oh, yeah, they did give us that. That's true, yeah.
And the sanitation.
Oh, yeah, the sanitation, Reg. Remember what the city used to be like?
Yeah, all right, I'll grant you, the aqueduct and sanitation are two things the Romans have done.
And the roads?
Well, yeah, obviously the roads. I mean, the roads go without sand, don't they? But apart from the sanitation, the aqueduct and the roads...
Irrigation? Medicine? Huh?
Education? Yeah, all right, fair enough.
And the wine?
Yeah, that's something we've really missed, Reg, if the Romans left.
Public baths.
And it's safe to walk in the streets at night now, Reg.
Yeah, they certainly know how to keep order. Let's face it, the only ones who could in a place like this.
All right, but apart from the sanitation, the medicine, education, wine, public order, irrigation, roads, a fresh water system and public health, what have the Romans ever done for us?
Brought peace?
Oh, peace! Shut up!